Juliet by Shakespeare, the question is raised, what's in a name? And then the statement is made, a rose by any other name would smell as sweet. A lot of times I've heard people use that to indicate to us that names are not really that important. And yet in reality, names are extremely important in this life. Names are important to God, so much so that there were occasions when God chose to change individuals' names. He changed the name of Abram to Abraham, and his wife Sarai, her name was changed to Sarah. He changed the name of Jacob to Israel, that became the name of the nation. And in the New Testament, Jesus changed the name of Simon to Peter. So names were important to God, sufficiently enough that God wanted to see to it that on occasions names would be changed because of what was needed. But perhaps the greatest change is the change in names that God gave to His own people. In the New Testament, God's people were called Christians. And that's a name that I believe is given to us by God. And it's interesting, though, in reading and listening to some people, there are those who indicate that in all likelihood that the name Christian came by means of the enemies of Christians who wanted to poke fun of them and gave them that name. In fact, William Barclay, in his commentary, in talking about this passage in Acts chapter 11 and verse 26, he said the people of Antioch were famous for their facility in finding jesting nicknames. And he gives us an example, the bearded emperor Julian, whom they called the goat because of that. And he said about the name Christian, he said it was a half-mocking, half-jesting, wholly contemptuous nickname. Even our brother J.W. McGarvey suggested that the name may have been given by enemies of the church, or perhaps was given by Paul and Barnabas. But I'm convinced in my own mind that this name was a name given to God's people by God Himself. Several years ago, I heard Brother West talking about this topic. And he pointed out that the Greek word that is used there in Acts 11, 26, when it says the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch, the Greek word that's used there is this word krematizai. In the New Testament, every time that word is used, it is always used either of God explicitly or implicitly calling or warning His people. And for example, Matthew chapter 2 and verse 12, in regard to the wise men. You know, when they came to Jerusalem seeking Him that was to be born King of the Jews, if you'll remember, Herod told them, you go and find this child to worship Him, then come let me know so that I can worship Him. But God knew that's not what Herod intended to do. Herod wanted to kill that child. And so when the wise men found Jesus there in the house, and they offered to Him those gold, frankincense, and myrrh gifts to Him, and then the Bible says they departed another way, and it makes the statement, being divinely warned in a dream. That word divinely warned is this word krematizai. It was God warning them to go another way. In Romans chapter 7 and verse 3, when it talked about an individual who is married and then before the husband dies, she marries someone else, the text says in Romans 7, 3, she will be called an adulteress. That's that word krematizai. It's not the world that gives that name, but it came from God to those who are living contrary to God's will in regard to marriage. In Acts 10, in verse 22, in regard to Cornelius, the Bible says that he was divinely instructed. That's that word krematizai again. Every time that word is used, it is used to suggest that what God does and not what man does. And so here in Acts 11, 26, I believe that it's God who is calling these people, these disciples, Christians. In Young's literal translation, and in our brother Hugo McCord's translation in the New Testament, this word is translated as, quote, were divinely called. And so it is. In fact, Thayer gives us a definition of that word, to give a divine command or admonition, to teach from heaven. And so it's a word used of what God does, not what man does. And so when the text says, they were called Christians, I'm convinced in my own mind that that means that God is the one who called them Christians. And that's in keeping with the things that God had said in the Old Testament, the prophecies of this. In Isaiah 62 and verse 2, God says, the Gentiles shall see your righteousness and all kings your glory. You shall be called by a new name, which the mouth of the Lord will name. the Gentiles would see the righteousness of God when the gospel was preached to them. That's how they would see how man is made righteous in the eyes of God. And at that time in Acts chapter 10, when it was preached to Cornelius, Cornelius was a Gentile, but he was one who was a God-fearer. And then in chapter 11, we read about the Gentiles being taught the gospel there in the city of Antioch. And so Barnabas sends for Saul and asked him to come help them. And the text tells us in that regard that when they came there, that then those disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. The Gentiles were seeing the righteousness of God. They were being taught the gospel and they were being brought into God's kingdom, the church. And that's when God gave them a new name, the name Christian. The name Christian was given by one who is our King, and we ought not to take anything else for that name. The name Christian also is a name that gives preeminence to Christ Himself, and Christ deserves that preeminence. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 18, Paul says, "And He is the head of the body of the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things He might have the preeminence." Christ is to be first place in all things in this life, to us especially. And the name that we wear ought to be the name that gives preeminence to Christ. In Hebrews 1, 1 and 2, God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken unto us by His Son, by whom also He has made the heir of all things. Christ is the one from whom we will inherit the blessings of God, and to Him deserves to be given the preeminence and the name that we wear. We ought to wear that name, Christian. There are some names that give preeminence to some man, or perhaps even to some doctrine, and such things as that are condemned in the Bible. When Paul wrote to the church at Corinth, he was writing to a church that was already beginning to be divided in different groups. There were those who claimed that they were followers of Apollos, some of Paul, and some of Christ. Paul asked a simple question of those brethren. He asked the question, "Was Paul crucified for you?" And question number two, "Were you baptized in the name of Paul?" And the answer to both questions were no. And what Paul is doing is showing here that you have a right to call yourself after someone if that person was crucified for you and if that person is in whose name you were baptized. And that means for us that we're to call ourselves only after Christ. He's the one that died for us, and it's in His name, by His authority, that we're baptized into Christ. And so we wear the name Christian, a name that all you would think could be in agreement with, that we've been known simply as Christians. And I remember Brother Jerry used to talk about that when someone asked him the question, "What are you religiously?" And he'd say, "I'm a Christian." And there's, "Oh, well, I understand that, but I mean, what kind of a Christian are you?" And he'd simply say, "I'm a simple Bible Christian." No additions to the other than that name which God has given to us. We are Christians. And so tonight, that's what we're endeavoring to do in the church, is simply to encourage people to become Christians and Christians only, nothing else. And you can do that by your faith in Jesus that would lead you to repent of your sins, confessing before men. You can be buried with Christ in baptism to have your sins washed away, at which time you become God's child. You're a part of His family, His church. You become a simple New Testament Christian. If you're tonight as one that's done that, but you know you're not living for God as you should, maybe you're bringing shame upon that name because of the actions you've taken and the way you live, if you'll repent of that and pray to God for the forgiveness you need, God has assured you He will forgive. He will bring you back again into His fold. You will be His child, a simple New Testament Christian. If you need to respond in obedience to the will of God tonight, we encourage you simply to do what God asks you to do, and do that now while we stand and sing.